Hey, what's up, good people? Welcome to another episode of Pwned. This video is going to be all about the Challenger Mark III by QWK. This Challenger Mark III does not belong to me. So a huge shout out goes to the person who loaned it to me. You know who you are. Thank you very much. I appreciate you loaning this to me and letting me mess around with it for like 2 weeks. So yes, everyone, I have a QWK Challenger Mark III. I'm just going to call it either the Challenger or Mark III, whatever comes to my mind. I think it's going to be quite a mouthful to keep saying Challenger Mark III. So anyway, this is a very interesting blaster and I'm going to give you guys a firing demonstration later on in the video. Let's first talk about the overall build quality and how it feels in hand, the ergonomics of this thing, my opinions about the aesthetics and all of that. Then we will get into the performance and all the other stuff like that. So first of all, let's talk about the price point of the Challenger Mark III, and let's get that point out of the way. This will run you somewhere along the lines of the $600 price range, which translates to about $450. And my opinion is that at that price point for this blaster, it's actually not too shabby. Honestly speaking, it's not the cheapest blaster, but it is also not the most expensive, and it could be completely value for money if this blaster is everything that you're looking for. Now, of course, I'm not saying that this blaster is everything that I'm looking for, but I can definitely see some very, very good pros about this blaster, and I'll be talking about all of those as we progress through this video. One of the key points that I want to bring up to add to why I said that about this blaster and the price point is that I own an FDL3, and the price of an FDL3 when it was on sale puts it about the same price range as the Challenger Mark III. So please keep that point in mind as you watch this video, because I will be referring back to that point at certain intervals. Now let's talk about the blaster. The overall build quality of this thing feels really, really good. This version in my hand here is the Challenger Mark III Pro version. The shell is injection molded. This is in the clear black or the smoky grey colorway, but the Pro version also means that the internals are made of faux metal. Now, from what I understand, there is a standard and a Pro version. The standard version features plastic internals. I think it was injection molded POM. I may be wrong here, guys. I remember it was POM, but I'll make sure and I'll put the correct material on screen. And the difference between the standard and the Pro version is exactly that. The Pro version features four metal internals, and you've got this bolt or charging handle here made in solid metal. There are two quick release takedown pins here that perform exactly just the way you'd expect them to, which leads me into talking about the overall aesthetics of the blaster. I am a huge fan of the way the blaster looks. I really like the sci-fi style of the blaster. I think it just looks so cool. So starting from the front, it's got this four muzzle thing, and at the front here, it looks to have these pseudo meat tenderizer muzzle brake, I don't know the correct term, but it's got the design, that pseudo meat tenderizer design. And inside of that is a bearing scar. Now, if I'm not wrong, QWK were the first people in the market to actually introduce the concept of scars using bearings. So the bearing scar harkens back to them. And yes, now there are other manufacturers producing bearing scars, but I believe that QWK was the very first that created the bearing scar. Now moving back, we have a top rail here. This is a flat top rail, standard Picatinny size. Then we got some window cutout slots here in this diagonal motif. And it doesn't just look cool, it also serves a function because the battery is housed in there. So this will act as sort of an air vent for the battery. Now on the underneath, if you guys have actually seen pictures of the Challenger Mark III, you would have seen other Mark IIIs that actually have some sort of a front grip, angle grip, or maybe even a vertical grip. This version here that was loaned to me does not have that. It does have the screw ports though, so I believe that you could purchase add-on front grips or whatever you would like to be added on here. On the side here, there are also some slots, some screw slots here, and I believe that these are for the side Picatinny rails that are not present on this particular blaster as well. Moving back a little bit, you have the QWK logo. This logo actually looks really cool, but they've got their actual company name just embossed in there, and it's literally like just in some very plain looking font, Ting Wu Ku Company Limited. Now, just above that is that charging handle or the bolt that I was telling you guys about. And you've got a little stopper here. And then moving back here, you have this Challenger motif, and I am not too much of a fan of the Challenger motif here. It's a very standard looking font given the italic treatment and then just kind of embossed in here. I wish there was a cooler looking logo, but then again, you know, I can't ask for everything, right? So you've got the Challenger logo here. Of course, the same thing on the flip side. Now, just above that are a couple more window cutout slots. Moving down here with the trigger guard, and we have the trigger. Now, I want to call out that the trigger is a switch type trigger. I mean, you guys can hear the clicking thing, so there is some sort of a feedback when you pull the trigger. It's a nice tactile feedback, so you can actually feel when you're engaging the switch, which is really, really nice. And the trigger is comfortable. The trigger guard here is very roomy. I could even fit two fingers in there. Of course, it all depends on your hand size. My hand size are basically, I wear a size M pair of gloves. And then this grip here, this grip is also very comfortable because it is very nicely rounded all the way around. It's got some motifs here as well, and this provides a very good grip. This here on the trigger grip is the mag release button. I love this mag release button style, but the downside is that this is catered more for right-handers, where you're supposed to actuate it with your thumb like that, so you can just release your magazine by pushing down with your thumb. Now, me using this thing with my left hand, I can push in just with this part of my left hand, like right underneath my index finger knuckle. I could push it in like that, or I could just torque my index finger back and push it like that. It's not too cumbersome for me. I have not actually experienced accidentally pushing down on that switch and then my mag will just drop. So yeah, all in all, I think it's quite well done. It's a very, very nice placement as well. Next, of course, this features a mag in grip sort of a system. So yeah, the mag well is here. We'll talk about that in a little while. Then it's got this very angular, very cool looking thumb hole stock. And then moving back here, you have the adjustable shoulder stock. And you can adjust it by using this lever here. So it's a lever, kind of swivel lever, or a left and right kind of lever, and you push it out to either side, and then you can extend your stock or you could collapse it. So this is interesting because, you know, you can actually do that. So you'd actually need two hands to extend the stock fully because of your one hand span limitation, right? So I'm not able to stretch it all the way out to the fully extended position. I'd have to kind of do that twice or lean it somewhere like on my shoulder and then push it, so they will go all the way. So there we go. That's the most extended length of the shoulder stock. Now, the amazing thing about this stock is that it actually has a total of 9 different points. Yeah, it's really, really small. This is my first time experiencing a 9-point adjustable shoulder stock. And that is it for the aesthetics of this blaster, guys. I have decided that I would reserve my opinions, the pros and cons, what I like and what I dislike about the blaster towards the end of the video. So yeah, that's the aesthetics of this. Now, overall build quality, this thing, guys, feels really, really solid. It doesn't creak, there's no warping, this thing just doesn't flex at all. It's super sturdy, I love it, it feels good. This thing feels really, really solid, with the exception of the shoulder stock, and we'll talk about that later on. But yes, keep that in mind. When the stock is in the fully collapsed position, this thing feels solid as a rock. And because this blaster is a fully automatic electronic gear system battery powered blaster, you won't actually be leaning this blaster against yourself to prime the blaster very much. So yeah, this stock, okay, you know what, I won't talk about that too much now, let me just move along. So yes, guys, the overall build quality of this blaster feels really, really good in hand. So the next part I'm going to be talking about is the basic operation of the blaster before we even go into the firing demonstration. Now, in order to access, say, for example, the battery compartment, or just to take a look, or closer look, I should say, at the plunger tube and gearbox system, or maybe, for example, if you want to change the barrel, or if you want to remove this muzzle and change it for another piece, the first thing you're going to have to do is to remove the kickdown pins. So just pull them out, simple and straightforward. And then what you're going to do is just lift off the top half of the shell, this cover here, and slide it backwards out. That's how you remove it, and then you expose everything on top here. So yeah, this whole piece like that. This is made of two separate pieces that are screwed in together. At least that's what it looks like to me. And you've got a sticker on the side here. So I'm going to put this one side, and let's very quickly talk about what is in here. Starting from somewhere near the front, this is the main battery compartment. There is a strap, a Velcro strap, that allows you to hold your battery down. So this is a LiPo battery that comes with a blaster. And this is a 3S LiPo battery. It is at 1100 mAh. 11.1 volts at 40°C. Interesting thing to take note of is that this battery features the XT30 connector, which is the same as what is on the Blaster. So if you're intending to use another different LiPo battery, you gotta keep it in mind that the Blaster natively features an XT30 connector. Now you could of course change this out to an XT60 connector like most other Blasters do, or you could just use an adapter or what you call a converter. I for one find it really strange. I'm not so sure why they chose to go for an XT30 connector when almost every other Blaster out there features an XT60 connector instead. Now the thing is, I actually have access to other LiPo batteries, but not a single LiPo battery I have is able to fit into this slot. I mean, yeah, you could fit it into this Velcro strap here, but I wouldn't be able to slip on the cover. So it looks like the Mark III will only work with a specific range of batteries due to the physical size. So yeah, let me just put this battery aside and show you guys the next thing, which is the removable muzzle piece. So once you get the top cover out, you can actually remove this already, but I wanted to remove the battery first because I wanted to talk about that. But here we go, removing the muzzle piece exposes the stock barrel with that bearing scar, the QWK bearing scar, which is actually quite cool, right? This thing just looks really awesome. And this is a perfect fit. So you just slide this on like that. And how it is held in place is via those quick takedown pins, because this slot for the takedown pin lines up with this slot here. Just like that. I believe that there are different designs of this muzzle piece available for purchase. So if you guys have access to that and you want something different, something of a different look or a different style, you can consider that. But this one actually looks quite cool already on its own. Now moving down here a little bit more, you actually have the magwell area, or the, I guess what you call the chambering area. So this is like what I would call the breech. Old school nerfers call the breech. I don't know if that term is still relevant in today's context, but in this breech area here, there is this thing that we used to call the dart gate. And I don't know if this is still called the dart gate, but there is this transparent plastic piece here, and that is what I'd call the dart gate. The dart gate is being held down to the Blaster via two screws, and those two screws, as well as the dart gate, are the same exact thing that is holding the barrel in place. Now, once these screws come loose, your barrel's gonna also come loose. So yes, you could easily change out the barrel if you wanted to for something like a different barrel length. But I've been told that the ramrod is the kind of ramrod that has an O-ring around it. And the chamfer on the inside, the internal chamfer of the barrel, plays a big part in the seal. So due to that, you might face some compatibility issues if you're looking to swap this barrel out for something else. Now next, I mentioned to you guys about the ramrod, and this ramrod actually features that dog bone style ramrod, so you could easily insert or remove a mag without the need to first prime the Blaster. And that makes a lot of sense because this whole thing is electronic. The way it functions is very interesting. We'll get to that in a little while. Now next to the ramrod is this piece here, which I call the bolt. So you could pull it back and you'll see that it actuates the ramrod as well. Let me just try and get that properly on camera, guys. Now hopefully you guys can see that, but yeah, you need to use this from time to time. And yeah, this thing does feel a little bit rough. It doesn't feel finicky. It feels sturdy, but it feels rough to actuate. And last but not least, of course, is your plunger tube and whatever else is in here is that gearbox. I did not disassemble this Blaster altogether because yeah, I wasn't sure if I would know how to put it back, so I didn't want to get that deep in. But it has this marking here, it says YES, on both sides. Basically, it says YES Mark III. So I don't know why is it called the YES Mark III when this is called the Challenger Mark III. But yeah, that's basically how the internals kind of look like, guys. You've got the control board over here as well, and I'll talk about that when we get into the firing demonstration. So that's that. I would say that overall, whoever designed this Blaster, whoever assembled it, did a good job because even the wiring is done very well, and it's all very neatly arranged, and they even used zip ties to kind of hold all the wires together. So all in all, like I said, build quality, fit and finish is actually pretty darn good. Now let's go into the firing demonstration, and this time is going to be a little bit different because I'm going to kind of interchange between the firing demonstration as well as talking about the operation of the Blaster, because this is a little bit different from what you would typically expect of a Nerf Blaster, or at least a full auto Blaster. It's got its own quirks, it's got its own specific way of handling. So yeah, I wanted to share that with you. But the biggest thing that I want to share right now at this point of time, this Blaster does not have an on-off switch. In order for you to turn it on, you connect the battery. In order for you to turn it off, you disconnect the battery. I would say that that's quite a big gripe, honestly. So yeah, in my opinion, like, you've got this Blaster and everything, but you don't have an on-off switch. Really, really strange. So let's now just connect the battery. put the cover back on, and yeah, let's just go through the whole thing together. Here we go. So my battery here, I'm just going to strap it in. I'm going to turn around and face this way because I want you guys to see that once you connect the battery, there will be a green blinking LED light. So I'll try and do this without blocking that on camera. Sorry guys, it's going to be a weird angle for me, but yeah, I'm going to connect the battery now. And you guys should be able to see that green blinking light. See that? Right here. Oh, you know what? You could actually kind of see it on the other side as well. So yeah, but it's a lot clearer on this one side here. Now the battery is strapped in and connected. Let us now put this cover back on. And you got to kind of slide it in. You got to make sure that this part with the groove here sits inside here before you actually kind of push it down. So this takes a bit of practice and a bit of coaxing because, you know, the alignment's really, really tight. So here we go. Just make sure this is really close in, and then yeah, everything's seated nicely. Now it's time to install the takedown pins. And that is two. This is the magazine that goes hand in hand with the Challenger Mark III. This is a proprietary magazine. There is no other magazine that will fit into this magwell. It is like a bullet-shaped mag. So yeah, that's one unfortunate point. But yeah, it uses these mags. I'm using these DartZone Pro Max darts. Shout outs to you, Vince. Thank you for the DartZone Pro Max darts. This is quite cool. And I think that the color of these darts work very well with my videos, like the setup and everything. So I think it's going to offer better visibility. I will be using these quite often. So once again, thank you, Vince. Appreciate it. Thanks for the darts, man. So first of all, this thing is turned on. You have a firing control unit here. This offers you a few different settings. Now it's on the extreme back. I want to say right or left to you guys, but you know, towards yourself, on the extreme back towards yourself. This is in the safe position. Then moving down, you have three other settings. The first is a single shot mode. The second is a burst three round shot mode. And then finally, you have the full auto mode. So just keep it in this safe position, and when you pull the trigger, nothing actually happens. This blaster, I'm gonna say it right now, the way it operates is very interesting. Before we go into the firing demonstration and put this mag into the magwell, this blaster is currently unprimed with the bolt or the ramrod in the forward position. So what happens now, I'm gonna insert the magazine and I'm gonna move this into the single fire mode. The first thing that happens when you pull the trigger is that this blaster will prime itself. Right now, the dart is sitting under the ramrod. So the first pull will see it priming and chambering the very first dart. That's what happens, okay? From now on, we can proceed to fire normally. So just a couple of single shots for you guys. Okay, those are single shots. Now I'm gonna go ahead and move towards the burst shot. So each pull will see three darts being fired. Here we go. Right, I've got 10 darts in that mag, and I've fired, if I'm not wrong, and if I didn't lose count, a total of 9 darts. Now this is what happens when this thing fires and then there are no darts left in the mag. So I've got it on the burst fire mode. If I pull, it will detect that there's only one dart left, so it'll fire one time, and this is what happens. So the bolt is now open. It stays open, it would not go back. That basically tells you, hey, your mag is empty. So when you squeeze the trigger in this position, right, nothing's gonna happen. So what you do is you just push your mag release lever and this mag is just, it'll just drop out basically. Gravity drop. Let me just grab another mag. This mag here has a total of 2, 4, 6, 7 darts. I initially put 10 darts in here, but then 3 kind of slipped out, and I'll talk about that in a little bit. So what you do is you then load your next mag and you see a little switch right here. Now you push the switch forward, and what that does is to close this because the blaster is now primed with the ramrod in the open position. So as I push this forward, you push it forward and it will close the ramrod like that, and then you can continue firing. So like I said just now guys, you saw I pulled the trigger and nothing happened. So if I pull the trigger in this position now, it's going to fire another 3 darts. So that was 3 out of 7. Let's go for another 3. And then a single fire. Oh, sorry, I put it into the safe mode. A single fire mode. And watch this guy stay in the open position once a dart is fired. So now it's open. When I pull the trigger, Nothing happens. So now that we're done emptying this mag, I will say it again, the blaster is now in its primed position with the ramrod in the back or the open position. If you take out this mag and you squeeze a trigger like that, nothing is gonna happen. But what happens if you don't have a mag and you then push this switch forward to close up the ramrod? If I pull the trigger now, it's going to fire. Dry fire, guys, unfortunately. So that's one big issue. Why? Because if I were to disconnect the battery now, the blaster is still in the prime position. There is no easy way to deprime the blaster. Now, on top of that, say for example, now you know that the blaster is primed and this breech is closed. I've now loaded up this magazine with 6 darts. I'll insert the magazine into the magwell. Now I'm gonna set this to the full auto mode. So from that point, guys, this blaster, remember, it is already primed. I've pushed that thing to close the breech. Now there are no darts in this breech. What you're supposed to do to prevent dry firing is now manually pull back on this and chamber a single dart. That's where this charging handle comes into play. So now I'm just gonna fire off all 6 using the full auto mode. Here we go. Just fired all 6 and it will stay now in the open position. The blaster is primed. You get the gist of it. Now that all this is said and done, how do we then deprime the blaster? Good question, right? You wanna first get one single dart and you gotta load it into the mag. Insert this mag here, then push this switch to close the breech, or the ramrod, I should say, and then set the blaster to the safe mode. Then what you're gonna do is hold down the trigger, and then while keeping the trigger held down, you wanna switch this into any other firing mode and keep the trigger held. And then after a couple of seconds, you'll see that this blaster deprimed itself. So let me just do that, but I'm gonna be firing it off in this way because now we've already chambered that dart in there. So set it to safe mode, squeeze the trigger, shift it. I'm gonna shift it to say, for example, the burst mode setting. And then it fires off that one single dart. And now the blaster is deprimed. It didn't dry fire because you had the dart in there. And then this bolt is also in the forward position, meaning to say that the breech is closed. The ramrod is now sealed with the barrel. That's usually how we store our blasters. You don't store your blaster in its primed position. And then finally, last but not least, switch it back to safe mode. And to turn it off, you have to disconnect the battery. I'm gonna have to do that right now, guys. Okay, now that I've disconnected the battery, let's talk about what just happened, what we just went through. So first of all, firing demonstration, pretty solid, not a single dart jam. And I've been using this blaster, running it through some tests and all, and it has never once misfired on me. It has never once jammed on me, which is pretty darn awesome. Speaking about battery life, like I mentioned, this battery comes bundled with the blaster itself. And through testing, some nerfers have actually shared that this would go through about 300 to 400 shots before the battery depletes to the storage level. So that's pretty solid. 300 to 400 shots from a battery like this is pretty good before the next recharge. Of course, when you're bringing an electronic blaster to a game, for example, or a Nerf War, you want to bring multiple batteries. So yeah, just keep that in mind. So all in all, yeah, that performance there was pretty darn solid. But like I said, guys, we have to also kind of talk about the way this thing handles and the operation of it in general. Most of the time, I always mention that the blaster is always in the primed position. That is a really, really cool feature in my opinion. So it is a give and take situation. Yes, it is quirky, it is troublesome to deprime the blaster, but when you get it running, when you have it primed for use, this blaster is always in the primed position, which means that the moment you feel that click on the trigger, the blaster is going to fire. So it will always fire first, and then it will prime again and chamber the next dart. So every trigger pull sees the blaster firing first, not priming, chambering, and then firing. So there is almost, right, virtually no lag between pulling the trigger and the blaster firing. And if we compare this to, say, for example, a flywheel blaster, the first thing that's gonna happen is that the flywheels have to rev up first. Then the pusher motor will kick in and fire the dart. But in the case of this, it's really just almost like when you pull the trigger on a Springer. It's a give and take, guys. The responsiveness of this thing is really solid, and it's always going to be staying in that prime position, right? So just make sure that you know when your blaster is primed or not. And one easy telltale sign is just trying to pull back on this bolt here. If you feel a lot of resistance, it means that the blaster is not primed. If this thing is really easy to actuate, it means that the blaster is currently in the primed state. So yeah, you know, all in all, guys, this is a very interesting blaster and I love the way it handles. I think it feels really, really good and the responsiveness is really solid. I like it a lot. But of course, like I said, the downside is that you have to really understand the system, know what you're doing, don't accidentally dry fire, don't accidentally just squeeze the trigger without any dart in there, things like that. The other downside about that is that now, in order for you to turn it on or turn it off, you have to disconnect or connect the battery. So let's talk about performance since we just ended the firing demonstration and we talked about the overall handling of the blaster. Now, I took some FPS readings of this blaster using the official darts for this blaster, and those darts are known as the Dragon Darts. Now, Dragon Darts are really interesting because they are essentially Ultra Darts that are in Stefan form, basically. It's using the exact same foam that Ultra Darts use, and it has a tip that is very close to the AF Pro dart tips, which is a very interesting looking dart, and it handles really, really well for this particular blaster. You could see from the image that I have on screen right now, performance of this blaster using those darts is like the 180 FPS range. Now, just for a full disclaimer, I did the FPS test using the Dragon Darts as well as AF Pro darts, and these are all fresh AF Pro darts and of course fresh Dart Zone Max darts. AF Pro darts and Dart Zone Max darts courtesy of Vince, thank you very much, appreciate it. And the Dragon Darts came together with this blaster when it was loaned to me, so I don't think those Dragon Darts were used. They look too clean, too nice to be used darts. So yeah, I use those. And another thing to mention is that all the tests were done using a fully charged LiPo battery with the stock barrel and this bearing scar, so in this exact setup here. So to get a very consistent 180 FPS range for the Dragon Darts, or likewise for the 170 or 160 FPS range using the AF Pro or Dart Zone Max darts, this thing is really consistent. I'm actually really surprised at the overall performance of this blaster, which is one of the reasons why I mentioned that I think for that price range, this is a really, really solid blaster. Now, this bearing scar, I didn't have a chance to really test the accuracy of it, but from what I've heard so far and I understand so far from people who have been using bearing scars are actually giving better performances versus the traditional scar or stringed scars. And yes, guys, I actually bought a bearing scar as well. It is the 10 degree twist scar, but I don't have the chance to actually test it out yet, so I apologize for that. But, you know, with a scar, to get 180 FPS, okay, you know what? Realistically, let's just say that this uses Dart Zone Max darts, okay, or AF Pro darts. So 160 to 170 FPS with that accuracy as well from a bearing scar in a compact form factor like this, almost effortless because you don't have to prime anything, Springer performance and that responsiveness. That is why I think that at that price point, this is a really, really solid blaster. Now, I want to tell you guys about some of the things I don't actually like about the build, or I guess the make of the blaster. And the biggest gripe that I have is this adjustable stock here. Now, the adjustable stock is really comfortable in this fully collapsed position, for me at least, right? This is absolutely comfortable for me. But if you are someone who prefers a different length, a little bit more extension away from you, or if you are someone taller than I am, you are not going to like the stock at all. I'm calling it right now because this is gonna be a universal thing. I bet all of us would unanimously agree that the stock sucks because the arms are made of plastic, guys. Watch the flex, just look. Look at it flexing. Oh my God, wait. Something popped. Oh shit. Something popped. That was quite scary. So yeah, the flex on this thing is real, guys. Look, even in the collapsed position, you could still flex it a little bit. And that is honestly rather disappointing. I expect better. Like, why are these not metal arms? I mean, I don't know. Like, yeah, for that price range, I'd expect at least, come on, these arms to be metal as well. The next thing I want to point out is this little firing switch selector. This thing just pops off. Like, it just pops off. It's not even held in securely. Sometimes when you're just adjusting it, this thing will just fly. Like, okay, right now, see? From what I understand, this is not an isolated situation. It is not just for this blaster. Other Mark III owners have the same problem as well. The next thing that I will say is something that is, I guess, to be expected. That is that this blaster is very, very back heavy because the gearbox is here, the metal plunger tube, all the internals are all here, and then you just have the battery and the FCU over here at the front. So yeah, it's very back heavy. The next thing, also another big gripe that I have, is the fact that this uses proprietary mags. I really don't like that. I really don't like proprietary mags. Okay, let's talk about mags. This is an angled mag, and it's got some instructions here on the sticker, right? It says no, and it says yes. And what that is basically doing is instructing you on how to load darts into this mag. Now, this is very interesting because the darts are supposed to be facing... Sorry guys, I dropped the dart. But the dart's supposed to be facing front in this orientation, and you want to load it this way. Now, because there is a groove here, most of us, natural instinct, what we do is we push down from here so that we can load the next dart in. But that's not how you're supposed to load this mag. You are supposed to push down from the back like that. You're supposed to hold the dart this way in order for you to maintain the angle like that. So this mag has to sit at an angle, but every single dart is supposed to be straight down like this. Like, you know what I'm trying to say, right guys? The dart's not supposed to be pointing in this direction along with the mag. It's supposed to be angled and almost in line all the way up. So yeah, see what I'm doing there? It's just natural, right? So push it down from the back and then load the next dart in this way. That is to ensure that all darts sit aligned and they are at the correct angle, just like that. The next thing I'm going to point out, guys, is that I'm loading this mag not with the Dragon Darts. And I mentioned again, QWK manufactures the Dragon Darts, and those Dragon Darts are meant to be used with the Mark III, but I'm loading the mag, the Mark III mag, with these Dart Zone Max darts. So let's make it 10 darts in here. And you could see that the darts are starting to get squashed. That's because the spring in here is actually pretty strong. At least it is substantially stronger than springs used in other mags. And that is because this mag, like I said, was designed to be used with those Dragon Darts. Let me just get a Dragon Dart to show you guys. Hold on. Okay, so I have here a couple of these Dragon Darts. The thing that stands out the most about this Dragon Dart is that it is made in the same bamboo style as the bamboo darts. I guess they were trying to get the best of every world, using the Ultra Dart foam, getting that bamboo design, and using an AF Pro dart tip. But this thing, you know, if you've ever handled an Ultra Dart before, you'd know that the body is really, really solid, super sturdy, and so you wouldn't get this kind of situation here. Now, the issue about using other darts, like as in like other darts in this particular mag, not the Dragon Darts, is that from time to time, you actually see your darts being pushed out gradually by this spring. And I'm just kind of waiting for it to happen. But yeah, it does happen, and generally it happens when you have, I think, about 10 darts in there. It is unfortunate, but that happens. See, so yeah, it just did that right there. So now it's got 9 darts in there, and I've seen it do this a couple of times, and I think the threshold is kind of like 7 darts in there before it actually just stops pushing darts out. But also, I think it could be the different type of foam being used. So if you have darts that feature slightly softer foam, this is going to be a big issue for you. It'll just like spit darts out from time to time. Exactly like that. Like, yeah, it just does that now. Guys, so I only have 8 darts left here. But yeah, I've watched it do this quite a lot. And from what I've seen so far, the maximum that it can hold is about 7 darts comfortably without pushing darts out that often. And I'm talking about using just these Dart Zone Max darts. So it could be just the foam type, maybe. For example, I did not see this happening to AF Pro darts, but I have heard people mentioning that it is an issue for them as well. So I don't know if there's a proper solution to this. Maybe a possible solution is to find some way to... I got a shock for no reason, guys. But yeah, I did that again. So anyway, I was saying, guys, maybe a possible solution is to find some way to bend these two arms or the lip of the mag a little bit closer. That might solve your issue. I don't know. The next thing about the mags that I wanted to point out is that I was given fair warning that these mags are super brittle. Someone actually dropped the mag once onto the ground, and one of the snap clips here at the base broke. So now the mag is rendered useless. I wasn't expecting that because this blaster is designed to have that gravity drop mag function when you actuate the mag release lever. You know, I don't know if adding rubber bumpers here is gonna help, but to know that at that price point for the blaster is not a nice thing. And on top of that, like I said, proprietary mag system, another negative point to that. And I realized I never actually properly showed you guys that this mag just drops when you push the mag release button. So yeah, let me show it to you guys. I hope I don't drop the mag though. So I'll just grab it like that. Yeah, so it works, guys. It works very, very well. Now I'm extra careful, guys. I'm just worried. But yes, drop mag. That's all my opinions, the pros, the cons, the good, the bad, what I like and what I dislike about the blaster. I'll bring it all back to the first point that I said, and that I find that this is a pretty good value for money at that price point. Once again, this blaster is gonna cost you about at the 600 Singapore dollar range, which is basically a 450 US dollar price range. And I'm comparing this, like I said, to the FDL3, because in my opinion, the FDL3 is basically the one flywheel blaster to rule them all. Like, ever since I got the FDL3, I didn't actually feel a need or want to own any other flywheel blaster out there, because it's got everything that I want. It's got an onboard system, ROF control, it's got speed control, you can control the number of darts it fires with each trigger pull, you could control the speed up, speed down time, things like that. It's just so good, and it runs off a single battery, you know, and it's relatively quiet because of the power up and power down of the flywheels and all that kind of stuff. But that is not as responsive as a system like this. Even for the FDL, if I were to set it to the higher settings, I would still need to allow it some time for the flywheels to fully spin up and get to the max RPM that I set it to be before it actually pushes a dart through those flywheels. And of course, when you push a dart through the flywheels, you know, the faster an ROF you have, gradually you see your darts slowing down over time, because the flywheels need to have the amount of torque, or the right amount of torque, to continue the same RPM while it pushes darts out. But in this system, the one thing that this doesn't have is an ROF control. But I think that the ROF is good enough. Given the fact that this blaster performs like a Springer, I feel most of the time I'll just be using it in the single shot mode, because it's more like an aim, look down my sight really quickly, pull the trigger and move on. Knowing that this thing is going to be pretty accurate, firing at 170 FPS on average using those AF Pro darts, I think this is really solid. This is what I need. It's not a spray and pray kind of thing. I've got the scar. Even if I really wanted to make sure that I hit my target, in case one shot doesn't work, I could always just push it to the burst fire mode. I don't think I'll be ever using this blaster on the full auto mode if I were to bring this to a game and use it. All in all, like, that responsiveness and the kind of feel that you get of this blaster is a totally different ball game from comparing it to any other flywheel blaster out there. But it is in that same price range, so like I said, it really depends on what you are looking for. This could be the perfect blaster for you. It is not the perfect blaster for me, but I think that it is a really, really good blaster. So much so that, in all honesty, after using this, I'm really tempted to purchase one for myself. Allow me to interject here, guys, with another con about the blaster. And this is something that I didn't think about while I was initially recording the video, and that's because it never happened to me. But this is something that I felt worth to share with you, because this was an issue reported by a few users of the Mark III. And this revolves around dart to barrel fit. Now, some users are reporting that when they use darts that seem to have a slightly tighter fit with the barrel, while operating the blaster, the tight dart fit gradually pushed the barrel out of that clamp. So yeah, they would actually experience flying barrels from time to time. It never happened to me, because I used the Mark III just only with the Dragon darts, or AF Pro darts, or Dart Zone Max darts. So I didn't experience that, but I thought that this was a really important point to share with you guys, because I mentioned to you guys about the ability to swap out barrels, but you also have to be careful about the seal between the pusher or the ramrod and the barrel itself. So dart fit is now yet another point to take into consideration. So that is it, everyone. We've come to the end. I've said everything that I wanted to say about the Challenger Mark III by QWK. Once again, a shout out to the person who loaned this to me. Really solid blaster. I have enjoyed my experience with it so far. And yeah, you guys know my thoughts about it and all that. Yes, thank you for watching and sticking all the way throughout. I hope that you found this video informative. I hope that you found it interesting. And overall, I hope that you enjoyed this video. I'm going to be signing off now, so stay tuned for the next video. I don't know when that'll be out. As usual, in the very typical psych style, I don't know whenever another video is going to be released. And sorry guys, I'm standing in a really weird position, because I'm trying to make the Mark III stand one side while I do the outro. So here comes the outro, guys. Drills pay the bills, and teamwork makes the dream work. Peace.